everyone. Welcome back to the Computer Vision course. In this second part of the first lecture, I'm going to continue introducing you to different applications of computer vision. In the last video, we were talking about 3D reconstruction techniques in computer vision. Let's continue there. So in the last video, we saw how different angles, if you're taking images when you're recording a movie, if you're taking images from different angles, you can reconstruct the whole scene and give it a circular motion, creating an impression of a maze, because how can you go around a character without actually simultaneously. So that was one of the very good application we saw of computer vision. Another one is human shape capture. So here you see President Obama. This is an example of how digital image or digital shape of President Obama, the previous president of the United States, was created. This setup is specifically for that kind of thing. You see that there are a lot of cameras here which are not on, and there are only some cameras which are on. So the technique requires that it records the reflectance and the reaction of your skin color to different brightness intensities, and therefore a lot of images are taken with different brightness intensities to create a realistic looking skin tone reflection of a particular person. These cameras are not normal cameras. These are fisheye lenses, and fisheye lenses have fisheye lenses. Fisheye lenses are basically an ultra wide angle cameras. It can capture more real world information in a particular frame, and due to that you see the images to be not very flat. You will see them to be a bit spherical in shape. It gets a larger field of view for a particular frame, and that's the advantage of using fish eye lenses. Here you see that the reflectance generated different skin tones for the president, and due to that it was superimposed on this left 3D shape generated of the president with his color skin. And this was the final bust of the president generated, which is clearly quite good. This is also a very good example of how computer vision meets graphics. So using different camera setup, different lenses, you captured a lot of information from the real world, and you created a model of the real world in the image domain. And graphics, computer graphics helps you here by rendering, by taking all this information and rendering it in a 3D format like this, for example. Another application is shape capture. So similar to the previous example, here you see, if you don't know this character, this character's name is Admiral Tarkin. He has featured in Star Wars movie franchise. However, recently he passed away, and in order to bring back his character, the movie producers went ahead and created something similar to what they did with digitizing President Obama's 3D shape. They collected a lot of images of this character from the previous movie and did a realistic looking character in the new Star Wars movie called Rogue One. Another example is of motion capture. So after taking a lot of images of the character, there are actors who impersonate this character, and then they go out and record the movie in this format. As you can see, they have on the top image, the characters are wearing different sensors, which are then superimposed with the avatars that is supposed to be created for that particular character. In this example, you see in the Dawn of the Planet of the Apes, the avatar is superimposed on the main actor, These actors have been pre-scanned with multiple images, high-resolution images, and then their movements during this shoot is superimposed on the new avatars to create this realistic-looking movements. In gaming also, in gaming industry, Kinect has done amazing job. Because of Kinect, a lot of applications have emerged, which uses depth sensing and motion capture as well as body movement recognition, even gesture recognition, to transfer these movements into the actual games in the form of in the form of gameplay or any other kind of movement. For example, when you go and check out these links, you will see that how innovative it is that mere a gesture captured by the Kinect camera along with the depth sensor can be transformed into different gaming movements. And it's very interesting and it's also challenging because, for example, when if you know how Mario game works, it's a 2D game where your character moves left and right and up and down. It's challenging because when you use Kinect to record this kind of movements, how would you continuously run ahead? You have to figure that out, right, somehow. So these applications are quite interesting and innovative. You should check them out. Another really interesting application, real world live application of computer vision algorithms is in sports, specifically American football. In American football, how it works is that they have to keep track of how many yards you have crossed in order to see who has more points. And in order to do that, this yellow line that you see drawn on the image is not actually there on the field. It is generated post-processing. But this is all live. So they have set up cameras on the field, and those cameras take images of this players and then superimpose these lines to give a very nice visuals for the audiences to realize whether the player has crossed a particular distance or not. The big challenge here is it has to work no matter what. Even if the grass is greener or if it is drier grass, it has to work. If it is a cloudless day or it's a cloudy day, it has to work. And if there is a player around, it has to clear the player. It should not superimpose the player, otherwise it doesn't look good. They draw this line, and they have a couple of human operators who take a preview before passing it on live. So it's a combination of ground cameras, human checks, as well as vision algorithm. But it works very nice. And this is a very good application of vision algorithm. In medical imaging also, there's a lot of work being done. If you're really interested in looking at in depth on how vision techniques are being used in medical imaging, for example, CT, 3D, computed tomography, X-rays, MRIs, even there are image-guided surgeries being done these days. A lot of work has been done by our group at Pattern Recognition Lab. Andreas Meyer works mainly in medical imaging, and there are a lot of more PhD researchers who are working along with him. So if you're interested in checking out different applications from simple image segmentation, organ segmentation to post-surgery, post-operative detections, the research lab at Pattern Recognition Lab does a lot of this research in a broad spectrum. Another interesting case of vision application is a driverless car, as we talked before. Let me give you a bit of more detail into why driverless cars are so important. So every year, there is an estimate from 2016 that in 2016 there were 1.35 million people, a million pe million deaths across the world, and there were 2.4 million people involved in car accidents in the previous year. So if self-driving cars or driverless cars will become reality in the future, there won't be any accidents because most of these accidents that I mentioned have been because of human inattention or human errors, and majority of them have been caused because of drunken driving. And by bringing driverless cars on our streets, we get rid of all these problems. The motivation of creating driverless cars does not just come up did not just come up in a few years. There was a DARPA challenge, so Defense Division of American Research, American government called DARPA, invested in this. They created the first challenge for driverless autonomous cars. So that was the first time it was created. This challenge was created. And if you have seen Patton introduction, I think this has been discussed there also. But I will go ahead and talk more. DARPA challenge gave motivation to create autonomous vehicles which can drive anywhere, navigate on their own. The first challenge was hosted in a desert area where there were no obstacles. There were just turns and long distance driving. It was hugely successful, and the next versions had a lot of performance improvements across all teams. In the first challenge, only one team was able to finish a certain distance. Nobody was able to finish the whole challenge. In the second challenge, the consecutive year, more than half of the teams were actually able to finish the challenge. So that was a huge improvement within 1 year. DARPA also created another challenge later, which was called Urban Driving Challenge. So instead of in doing this challenge in the desert region, they created this challenge inside the city streets. And this was where they kicked off the research in driverless cars on our streets. Uber, for example, is one company in the line of a lot of companies which is heavily investing on creating driverless cars. And along with Google and Facebook also, even Apple is also investing in creating driverless cars. Nvidia also has a huge division which works for driverless cars. So if you are interested in driverless cars, you should go and look at the research done by these companies. This is a closer look to the sensors the driverless cars has. It has a lot of sensors, including a LiDAR sensor, as you can see this vertical thing. LiDAR sensors are quite useful for vertical field of view. It has a huge vertical field of view, so you can take a look at how many things are there in your vertical field of view. This is another example of Google Street View car, which goes around the streets in this whole world and takes images from the street and generates this 3D visuals of the surrounding. If you want to check it out, just go to Google Maps, use the Google Maps in browser or you're in your device, and you can put yourself inside the location, inside on the street, and you can look at a 3D view of the surrounding that was created by image stitching, by a large scale imaging done by this Google Street View car. Then vision is also applied in industrial robots also, from manufacturing cars to cleaning cars to manufacturing components of cars, and these are all vision-guided robots, and they are not running on the wheels, or they are not going from one place to another, but they are just located, and they are like a robotic arm which has a very fast and in continuous work, so they don't get tired, and that's the advantage. We see vision being used here also all the time. Another really interesting application for vision is in space exploration. If you go and check NASA's JPL lab, you will see that there is a lot of images being uploaded there. And these images are not just simple images. These are panoramic images which have been generated by image stitching. And most of the rovers that NASA sends on the and other countries that send on other planets or moons, they are unmanned. And in order to navigate these rovers in an uncharted territory, you need vision. So therefore, vision is very essential in space exploration. Starting from 3D terrain mapping, localization, object detection, position, orientation, it can vision can do all of these tasks simultaneously, and therefore it is an integral component of rovers being sent for space exploration. Another really interesting is in smaller challenges like autonomous football playing. For example, on the right, the RoboCop Federation has this reoccurring challenge, which in which they compete between two teams playing football. The players or these small robots do not really have a vision system because it's too small to have a big camera, a good camera fitted inside it. What is done or what is allowed during these competitions is they keep a camera at the top, and you can navigate your or you can move or control your robots or your players using that camera, using the vision generated by the camera. So you are able to detect and recognize where your smaller players are, and then you can accordingly guide them from that. Another one is so on the right you can see also this is a view of a drone. So Amazon launched this drone program where it would deliver your orders through drones, and this is how the drone maps the terrain when it's on the in the air. And drones is also a very interesting application of vision because it has to navigate on its own, localize itself on its own, and orient where to go. So these all smaller components, they work flawlessly together. And if only this there is no flaw in this, then the drone is able to fly. Otherwise, it's impossible for it to even take off. As we saw before earlier also in augmented reality and virtual reality, these vision techniques are used heavily. As you can see in this both the examples, the person is wearing the HoloLens, and it's he's able to visualize these different interfaces or these different characters inside the HoloLens as if it is in real. So this is also another very good example of use of computer vision techniques as well as graphics. Vision generates your location, it creates and maps, it maps the location around you, and graphics renders this world view inside your whole inside your lenses, and it creates a perception of reality. And it's very interesting for gaming applications also. So we come back here to where we started, kind of. Jitendra Malik, as he said, the 3 R's of vision are reconstruction, recognition, and reorganization. We saw that most of the applications are more are concentrated or related to these ideas. Although vision is not limited by these, however, every day we see a lot of different applications being developed, and they are loosely related to vision or not. And it's always a debate whether it's a real whether it belongs to vision or it belongs to a statistical analysis or it's just feature engineering and things like that. So according to him, according to Jitendra Malik, the next steps that we are going to take is essential, and it should be done in the it will be done in the direction of reorganization, or more like how to study the interaction of different vision algorithms. So when we saw before previous examples of self-driving cars or even drones, so these devices, they use a lot of different vision techniques to work smoothly and to function. And therefore, Jitendra was able to say this this statement that it requires the study to the interaction between these processes, and it's very important for a computer vision's future. We already saw a few examples of how vision and graphics are related to one another. Both of them are trying to create a model of the world in one sense. Graphics kind of re wants to recreates the model of the world, whereas vision tries to see the world and understand, learn the parameters that make the real world. And both of these work with different sensors, different images, but they have a very smooth interaction between them. And this creates a model for us to work with. For example, when you're designing a drone, you need to have this model or a blueprint of the surrounding and where you want to go. So it's a simultaneous process of mapping your surrounding as well as taking action to navigating the surrounding. So it's both of them are dependent on one another, and they work quite smoothly with one another. However, there are few other definitions of vision with respect to different related fields. For example, geometry. When you look at a lot of vision algorithms, they are heavily dependent on geometrical aspects of objects or even physical aspects. What it means to vision to have these geometrical aspects? Does it really make it a vision problem, or is it really a geometry problem? So, in mathematics, geometry is treated very rigorously. However, in vision, we are not treating it so rigorously as the mathematicians do. However, we let go. We are a bit flexible in terms of rigorous treatment. However, our focus is on tractability. So, whatever geometric features we use, we want it to be tractable. We want to know how we generated that and how we can go back from that. And that is very important for vision, to know tractability. Same goes for graphics also. Another important derogatory summary kind of vision is given is that it's just machine learning applied to some visual data. As I said before, it is a big debate on how certain problems can be casted to be vision problems and some problems are not. It's always a debate, and sometimes when you have just statistical analysis of some visual data, it could simply be a statistical analysis, but if you are using it for any vision problems, then it becomes a vision analysis. And therefore, it's a bit more flexible in this definition also. Same thing with physics also. We are using a lot of physics. So when we are generating the model of the world in vision, we are keeping the physical constraints constant. For example, when you're creating a model of an apple, you want its surface to be like how a real world apple looks like. And in order to do that, you have to enforce some physical constraints on that. However, these constraints are not so strict, because as I said before, our focus is more with tractability than rigorous treatment. So a physics professor or a person working in physics would consider this to be a very trivial application of physics. But for vision, this is very important. And for us, it is important that we give equal importance to physical constraints as well as the creation of real-world models. Thank you. And this brings us to the end of the first lecture of computer vision. I'm hoping that you enjoyed it, and if not, please ask it in the forum. In a couple of days maximum, we will be able to reply to you. If not, you just write a mail. Next we will start the second lecture for the next week. And I will start treating I will start and introduce you with light and color, and then we will move on to image filtering, frequency domains, corners, edges, so on and so forth. There's a lot to come. We have a lot to learn. And I hope this first lecture is motivation enough for you to learn more about these techniques and learn the actual technical aspects of how these things work. It's going to be a lot of fun. Thank you.